Hi, I'm Fred McNeil, and thank you for watching QACTV 7. You're watching a show called Conversations with Fred. Each week, I have interesting people from our community come on and tell you what's going on. I have a good person today, Commissioner Jack Wilson. Jack, thank you for coming today. It's 90 degrees, you've got a job to do,
yes, you got it made. Yep.
But the good news is, when you leave here, you only have to go to a job here in Centerville.
Centerville, yes. Stay on the side
of Jim Moran, he's stuck in Northern Virginia. Yes. Hey, Jim, see you next Labor Day.
Yeah, I don't envy him at all for being on that side today.
Jack, what I've been doing with the commissioners, we'll do two things if it's all right with you.
Sure.
First part of the show, let's let the people get to know you a little bit. Ask you some questions, where you grew up. Are you another Severna Park guy?
I am.
You've got me beat.
I am.
We'll talk about that. And then how about we talk about all the good things you're doing as a commissioner, okay?
Great.
So let me ask you this. Where'd you grow up? Where was young Jack from?
So actually, I was born in Baltimore City.
Okay.
Moved to Arnold, just across the bridge, when I was two. So I've been down this end of the world for 53 years now. So,
But
I graduated from Severna Park in 1984.
You, Jeff Strait, Kerry Lee O'Connor. I go on for 20, every place I go, church, work. Hey, I went to Severna Park.
Yeah, there's a big migration from over there over to here. But honestly, my roots come, on my dad's side of the family, are from the Lower Shore.
You're from
Federalsburg? Federalsburg, Carolina, Secretary.
Folks.
Yep, Secretary, grew a bunch of oystermen on that side of the family from back in the day. So I just basically came back to my roots by coming back on this side of the bridge.
Now, it's Severna Park High. Car guy, sports guy?
Played basketball, sports.
You played basketball?
Yeah.
I was the head coach of Queen Anne's County and assistant for years. Severna Park would beat us every time. You guys had...
We actually came and played Queen Anne's and got spanked my junior year, yes.
That was definitely not the year I was head coach.
Okay. that team was phenomenal. They were just...
Oh, that was when Merv Doherty had this Bam Winchester and all those good players.
Yes,
One plays in the NBA, one's playing in China.
Yeah, no, it was. They had a great team that year.
What position did you play in the basketball team?
Forward.
Oh, you're a good height. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So. Who was the coach at Severna Park in those
days? So the year before I started, Coach Saylor took them to the state championship.
Oh, the state championship.
Yeah, and then Wayne Mook came in and became the coach after that. So.
Well, last thing amazing about Severna Park High. Not only are we good athletically, you have the greatest academics. And everyone from Severna Park had great SAT scores, went on to great colleges, all types of good stuff.
Yeah. No, it was a good school to grow up in. And like I said, it was funny because coming up, when they built Broadneck Elementary School, I had gone to Belvedere Elementary School.
Okay.
Well, they split it, so half the kids, the kids in St. Clair went to Broadneck. Okay. We stayed in Belvedere in the Arnold area. Then when we all came back together in middle school and junior high, and then when we went to the high school, it was the year they opened Broadneck High School, so we split again. So, because we would have had close to well over 2,000 people would have graduated that year had we not split.
Because Jeff told me at some point Severna Park High School was on double shifts.
Yes, we were. My junior year, we were double shifts, yeah.
Okay, was that big? Lord.
Because the people that were staying at Severna Park after they built Broadneck, went in the morning, and then the kids that were going to Broadneck, which were the juniors, I guess it was juniors at that time, maybe sophomores, they were going in the evening.
Okay.
Afternoon, so yeah.
Now, Jack, let me ask you, am I right, politics is in your blood? Do you have family that's run for office? Straighten me out on this story.
Yeah, so my dad actually ran as a write-in for Congress against Andy Harris and Frank Cravel.
United States Congress?
Yeah, in 2010. Yeah, he got the petitions, well, he thought he did, the signatures, but they disallowed him. He's actually part of the law where they went back and looked at how they count a signature. Back then it used to be how you signed your voter registration card, literally, because they denied my signature on his petition.
Really?
Yeah,
because you signed your name?
Because I signed up to vote when I was 18, and apparently I didn't sign my name the same at 38, 40, whatever it was. So they disallowed mine. My wife, neither one of our signatures were. But anyway, so long story short, he had over 10, 11,000 signatures, which should have put him on the ballot as an independent, but they disallowed all but 200. So they went back and they changed the law. Now it's intent of the signature.
So politics is in your blood.
It is,
Your dad did it, did it. Any other members of the family
running for
you?
No, that's it. The lineage stops here, I think, because I don't think either one of my kids have an interest in it. So.
Okay, now you mentioned your wife. You guys, are you still real big in the Kent Island Beach cleanup group?
We have not gone this year. I think the last time we did was last year. But we will get out to at least one of
them. You were always
there.
I mean, every time I went, you guys were there, and your wife was vice president or treasurer?
She was treasurer since the beginning of it, so yeah.
So you're acting not only commissioner and beach cleanups was a good deal.
Yes, it was, and it was a lot of fun. Now they got so many people doing it, it's just,
which
you know,
yeah.
Somebody my age just gets out there and gets in the way, so.
Well, you donated a trailer 1 year, did you not?
No. We helped put it together.
Maybe that's what it
John,
was. Together.
John actually, John and Kristen actually, the KIBCU actually bought a trailer later.
Oh, okay.
And so we were able to take it down. But I worked with them to get them to be able to bring the trailer down to the site, so it was easier to set up and that kind of thing. But they've done a great job with it, and now it's just kind of blossomed. And
it's great. So. They do a great job.
Absolutely.
Now, Jack, let me ask you, all the commissioners, you're all so busy in so many things.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me, give us a little update in the areas that you really like.
So I going all the way back to 14 when I ran the first time, is two of the things that I've always kind of pounded on is broadband expansion in the county.
Right.
And I think COVID has really opened everybody's eyes to just how
much you need that.
Much you need it, especially in the rural areas. And the good news is, been a lot of money put aside now to expand broadband.
Is it federal money? Is that what
there's federal, there's state. We've actually set aside money as the commissioners to get some matching grants to help expand it. And quite honestly, North County right now, which is the largest unserved area, obviously, in the county, they've got three different vendors up there putting in fiber. So, and that's the great news. We're getting to the unserved areas. But the flip side of that is we've also got, the island and all, which had existing decent broadband for the most part.
Right.
ABB, obviously, is the main provider up there. But the problem is, the equipment gets older, technology gets, so...
It changes so rapidly.
Exactly.
Right?
And so we've got to stay ahead of that curve by making sure that we're able to, help the providers where we can to upgrade their equipment so that we can stay on the leading edge. There's still a lot of coax cable in the ground on the island that should,
that's got to be taken out.
Should be fiber at some point, because fiber's just, it's going to be here long after we're all dead and gone, still doing its thing, so.
So how long the Queen, are we at the point now we're as good as any other county? The kid in Northern County, how soon will he be as good as the kid in Severna Park?
So, Fred, I'd say we're...
That's a tough question.
Well, no, I'd say, in all honesty, we're probably in the 5-year range right now to where we can, we'll have connectivity and...
Good.
I'd say we're going to be in the mid to upper 90s in 3 to 5 years.
Okay, so you can work from home.
Right.
The students can work from home.
Right.
You're going to be able to get on the internet, that type of thing.
And it's fiber. So most of what's going in now, everything in North County that I've seen up there is fiber in the ground.
Okay.
So we've got Chop Tank Electric just came on board this past year. So they're another provider that's going to start hitting North County. There's actually going to be competition up there.
All right, first time ever. Right?
Yeah, exactly. So it's it's exciting to see it happen.
Well, that's your area. You're the North County guy.
Yes, come on. Yes, and it's great to see. Like I said, I think there's a lot of bad things came out of COVID, but
this is a plus
that came out of COVID. Absolutely.
And if I'm a parent, I'm delighted. You know what? Maybe I can work from home in the next couple of years, if not right now. And if I'm a student, hey, don't panic. The only thing they're panicking about, Jack, no more snow days, maybe.
Yes.
Get on the internet. No days off.
Yeah, the virtual works in the reverse.
It's ruined fog days and snow
exactly.
days.
Exactly. Right. But you bring up a great point. One of our biggest headaches here, and it's you could call it the elephant in the room, but it's not. It's just there, and that's the traffic in the summertime.
Mm-hmm.
For having the ability for people to be able to work remotely and avoid going across that bridge, much as I tried to on Fridays myself, that's a luxury that brings lifestyle, gives you some semblance of lifestyle here.
It makes a week a little our friend Jim Moran is stuck in Northern Virginia, wherever he is.
Yeah.
He wishes he somehow didn't have to cross that bridge. Imagine all the county and government workers working in other counties if they could stay home on a Friday, especially for the 3 months of summer.
And I think you're going to see that, honestly. I think, again, something that came out of COVID, I think you're going to see more, and even in the private industry, public sector, you're going to see more of what they call flex schedules.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe you'll work a 12-hour day on a Wednesday or a Thursday to get yourself to where you can work remotely. Right. And those are kind of some of the things we have to think of outside the box in terms of looking at some of this traffic. How do we help our people? Because this traffic passing through here is not our Queen Anne's County citizens. We know where it's going. It's going to the beaches. It's coming from the north now with the expansion up in Middletown. I mean, we've seen an enormous uptick in southbound traffic and northbound traffic.
I teased my friend Jay Falstead. I said, Jay, what's happening on Kent Island is one thing.
Mm-hmm.
But watch out, Middletown, Delaware folks are going to start heading this way, like you just mentioned. Right?
Absolutely.
And that's going to It's going to be some difficult decisions to be made, right?
Well, and that, we got to get SHA on board with doing something with these at-grade intersections we have in North County. I mean, they're the most dangerous intersections you can
come to. Oh, yeah, coming out of that Sellersville turnaround thing.
I, 405, that cross over there, if they have 2 to 3 accidents there a week. It's just ridiculous.
Are you guys working on that now?
So that one's a tough one because they don't have the right-of-ways to be able to do a J-turn. And I know people would hate to hear me say this, but that's one, you know, like they did with Rolling Bridge because it was so dangerous. May have to look at just shutting that down to save, you know, lives. Yeah, yeah. Because
between you and me now, that's perfect. Just going out to 301 here with the circles, double circles, that works great.
Yeah.
I hope Sellersville and Churchill and those places get something like that in the future.
Well, we have 11 of them. I counted them.
11 of them?
There's 11 from the Delaware line, including Cecil, Kent County, down. Yeah. And there's a lot of accidents. There was one this morning right at 3 o'clock in the morning right there at the rest stop crossing over. And it's actually a friend of mine was the person that hit the other vehicle.
Everybody okay?
Yeah, everybody's okay. But it's just, you know, that's a constant thing. The other thing is these at-grades, I've seen many people turn and go the wrong way on 301.
Oh, I know.
You know, they just come up there and I guess they lose focus. They're on the phone, whatever they're doing, and they'll make a right and head north into southbound.
Lord, his headlights coming at me.
Exactly. So, you know, those are all things we got to work with SHA. We meet with them twice a year. We meet with them at MAKO convention. We meet with them in our CTEP program, and it's been on our list with them. You know, you got to do something about this.
So you're knocking at the door, telling them to be aware of it.
Yep, we're pushing it. So, I mean, it's, you know.
Now, Jack, I know one of your big areas is education. And first, let me just say, you and the Board of Ed, everyone who's involved in it, new superintendent you're going to love, and the community's going to love. She's a listener, a hard worker, and wants to compromise and work with the community. So congratulations. That part of your job, I think, is going to be easier. If it's any part's easy.
Yes. Well, let's face it, education's the largest part of our budget. Yes. So it's the one, and it's the thing that you have a lot of people with vested interest in education because we have a lot of kids in the program.
7,000 plus kids. Right?
Exactly. So you're affecting, you know, 14,000 people total with the parents and all that. It's a big part of the community. It is important. And Dr. Salins comes from Caroline County, and she was a big advocate. She built quite the CTE program in Caroline County, so I'm really excited about that.
Now tell us about that. I know that's an area of interest. Where are we? And make sure everyone knows what CTE for us old folks is the old vocational high.
Vo-tech,
we don't call it that anymore.
Right. Okay. Vo-tech, CTE, career technology, education, that kind of thing. So, 2 years ago, pre-COVID, we had worked with Delegate Greist and Chesapeake College. Mm-hmm. We actually got legislation passed that would allow the 5-county region served by the college to establish a regional tech center at the college campus.
Right at the college.
Right, and would have a dual enrollment side to it. So it was primarily going to focus similar to Washington County's CTE program.
What do they have? I'm not familiar.
So they have an incredible, they have a full-size high school, literally. Okay. And the kids
and
go there.
It's just a vocational or CTE high school?
It's career paths. They have 17 different career paths that the kids are to do from all the way from law enforcement to electrical, carpentry, HVAC, plumbing, all, you know.
Everything.
Yeah. Criminal justice, CAD. I mean, it's a great program. So we actually took the chamber, Linda Friday at the chamber, put together a bus trip. We took out all the guidance counselors and everything from here and the surrounding counties. We went out to Washington County for a visit, just to walk to campus and see what it was all about.
Yeah.
And they've been around since 1972. So
they're experts at it now.
Exactly. So it was like, you know, we don't have to reinvent the wheel. Let's just see what they're doing and let's take whatever parts we can and make them work. So that was kind of the genesis of working to get this legislation to use the college because they have a similar relationship with the Washington Community College dual enrollment. So the kids are, you know, and you can sell it to the parents that way because you can say, look, your kid's going to get college credits while they're learning a trade or they're, learning to whatever the career paths are. You know what I mean?
College credits, you get your high school diploma, you get it all wrapped into one package.
And they have a 98% employment rate out of that high school.
You're kidding me. No. So if you go through that, get your degree, you're probably going to get a job. That's 98%.
If you don't already have it before you leave, honestly. So they got a lot of internships and things like that. So, you know, that's kind of what we're trying to emulate here. Of course, then COVID struck. So, again, that kind of
slowed it down for a year.
It brought us back. But in the meantime, Dr. Coppersmith over to college, since he's come on, he came from the background of CTE-based community colleges.
Okay.
So he's brought a lot of that knowledge to Chesapeake. And they've developed, I want to say, 6 to 8 programs, and they're getting ready to launch a culinary program, which is really exciting.
Especially on Queen Anne's County with all of our restaurants.
Exactly. Right? Yes. And, you know, and they're hurting for chefs and things like that, people to work in there now. So, again, that's going to kind of mold right into what we have here. And the high schools are going to be involved. So it's actually going to be a full-blown, what I consider, CTE program.
Okay.
The goal is to get it into some more areas, you know, where so the college has an electrical program, they have an HVAC, but we need to get that down into the high school level where we're bringing kids, you know, we're getting them as young as 8th grade, where we're, you know, convincing them and more importantly their parents, hey, this isn't a bad way, this isn't a bad life.
Not everybody needs a college degree, and we're finding, Jack, I mean, what I read, and I know in my life, I can't get a plumber, I can't get an electrician.
Right.
Anybody out there knows how to install fences, come call me now. People who can work with their hands, young men and young women, we're begging for them, right?
Yeah. Well, it's, you know, I came up in the era where it was like you were shamed if you weren't going to college. And you know, I lived through that, and I went in, I was 19 when I got into the apprenticeship, and I worked my way through the apprenticeship. And I don't have any regrets. Yeah, it was hard work, and you come home dirty, and you come home late, and you work long hours a lot of times.
Jack, I was an educator. Plumbers, electricians, heating and air conditioning guys, they make more money than I have. They have better benefits than I have, and they're certainly driving nicer cars.
And they got big boats, too, a lot of times.
They have bigger boats.
But, yeah, so, you know, to me, that's I think this is a great opportunity, and I think it'll be a great opportunity for our kids here in the county to, you know, develop other career paths. My thing is give them as many opportunities as possible. Let's not limit them to what they want to do.
Jack, is that a five-year plan? How do you think, where are we? I mean, right now the kids, you tell me if I'm wrong, we have the vocational, I call it hallway at Queen Anne's County High. We bust the kids up from Kent Island High School.
Correct.
They do the vocational class. Then they have to go back again for classes. It's a little inconvenient. And this program, like you said, is a great one at the high school, but certainly if you worked with a community college, it would get bigger. So how close to a couple of years?
Yeah, so I just met with Delegate Grice again, and we kind of circled back as to, okay, how can we get this thing back, you know, moving it back down the field and try to score, So we're going to be meeting with Dr. Coppersmith, the college people. Like I said, they have put together a great core of people over there. They're working already. So they've done a lot of the legwork. Like I said, we got Dr. Salins in here. She comes from a great background of this. So I think we're going to have all the players in place. You know, it's just going to be a matter of pushing forward. And like I said, there are some programs that are already up and coming.
Existing. Yeah.
So it's good.
Is the money there from the state okay? Or we don't know yet? Is that why you had to meet with the delegate?
Well, so that was, you know, that was kind of one of the things we looked at was... how do we get the business community to back this? And because then the business community become a source
partner,
of...
the partner.
Right.
Yeah.
And so we've, since we hired Connie, she works for the Economic Development Department.
Okay.
But she is actually a county employee for us in Kent County. It was a grant program through the Upper Shore Regional Council. We were able to start this. Well, what she does is she's a liaison between the college, our schools, and our businesses.
Okay. So she'll try to tie them all.
That's the three-legged stool right there.
Yeah.
You know what
I
mean? So you can't really expand CTE without all three of those legs.
No.
So now we have a person in place who is working between them. So I think that's going to help it. Yes. I think that's going to help get it moving in the right direction, too.
And we don't have to build a new building. We'll just tag along with the college. So we don't.
They have two buildings there, actually, for us.
Oh, they have?
Yeah. They have the old Manufacturing Trade Center, which they're remodeling now.
Right.
And they have the old, ironically enough, the Queen Anne building.
So the structure, I mean...
We don't need
bricks
and mortar right now.
We've got the bricks and mortar already out there.
Right, we already have
that.
Terrific. Yeah.
So. And if we get that, if I was a young person out there, you know, 7th or 8th grader, you know, it might be that they could get into a program, get college credits, get a certificate, and like you said, 98% of them are probably going to get employed.
Yeah.
You can't beat that.
Before high school's out, they'll be employed. I can guarantee you that nowadays. So.
And Jack, any other things on the burner that you're concerned about or working with the commissioners we all need to know about?
Right now, well, we got the comp plan. I think that's...
Amy and Stephanie here, and they said they're working with you, and they've had public meetings, and that's where we're going to be in 10 years, I guess.
I think that's the next big thing on the horizon that's going to have to get done.
And
right
you
now
all
it's
have to approve it, correct?
Correct,
five
yes.
commissioners. Okay.
Yeah. And it's November, I think, right now is the scheduled time frame for it to
It doesn't slow down, does it, for
commissioners? No, that's for sure.
Now, Jack, I asked all the commissioners, what do you enjoy most about being a county commissioner? Just a personal thing. It might be the meals at Chesapeake. I don't know. What's the best part of the job?
I enjoy all the interaction.
With the people,
with the
public.
With people in the public. And being able to, where I can, solve problems. And where I can't, tell them why I can't. a lot of people have, and I guess it's just a disillusionment that at every level of government, you have the same power. And
sure.
At the county level, there's things we can do and there's things we can't because of state or federal.
We've had a couple commissioners say, Fred, the roads, the state roads, we can't do what we'd like to do.
Yeah.
The bridge, we can't do what we'd like to do. The state's going to tell us what to do. We get input, but that makes your job. It's tough for the public to understand. Jack Wilson doesn't tell them what to do with
right.
the bridge or Route 50 or Route 301, right?
And we've tried, we've put a ton of recommendations up. I give Jim and Steve Wilson credit. They've done a lot with recommendations, and then we come together and we vote on them and we push mm-hmm. them up in the form of letters. Or we even sent a 8-foot drawing to them to show them what the corridor, what, you know, the improvements that were needed
right.
that we
right.
thought would work. And, you know, we were shut down for years, but honestly, now I think they're getting a little more open-minded.
Good.
One of the early things that Jim had actually came up with was to meter the lights further down, 301, so you could control the traffic getting to the island.
Okay.
And they said they tried it, but they tried it in February. I don't know that that really helped us.
No,
you know.
No traffic in February.
But the problem we're having now, Fred, is we don't have any way of controlling the traffic southbound from up north now. And you talk to anybody up north now, even coming out of Centerville.
You're beginning
you
to
see
get the traffic.
Pennsylvania, Delaware, New Jersey, New York. That's all you see, tag-wise.
Jack, we're amazed. Me and Bill Moore, we help the sheriff. We ride bikes on the trail and help. In the parking lot at the beaches, like you said, New Jersey,
mm-hmm.
Pennsylvania. I don't see any Maryland tags.
Yeah.
I don't see it. I see Virginia, but like you say, they're coming here, right? And that makes your job a lot
tougher. It does. And you know, with some of our parks, like Terrapin Park, you know, we had that with the COVID last year, we had the huge crowds showing up there.
Oh, yeah.
And a lot of people were saying we need to shut it down and things like, again, that park was purchased and was mostly built under what they call Project Open Space money.
Federal money, right?
Well, it's state
money.
State money. And so there's, you can't limit who goes there.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
you know, and that's a lot of things. You know, a state road, we can't limit what's on Route 18 because
yeah.
that's a state road.
You can't stop people on 50 and say, you can't go any further. No,
exactly.
It's a state road.
And everybody's like, well, we need to shut this down here. And I think,
yeah.
you know, my comment back to him a lot of times is, yeah, well, are you thinking of that when you're on 395 or you're on, you know, 270 and you're in somebody else's backyard? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You're in somebody else's backyard.
Sure.
They probably think the same thing. They don't want to see you there either. So it's a bad situation. It's something that's been let fester. You know, the last bridge opened in 72.
And he keeps kicking the can down the road.
Exactly.
Let the next guys take care of it. Next women take care of it.
Yeah, no. I think supposedly they made an honest effort in the early 90s and it failed. And, you know, and here we are.
Same problem. And I agree with what you said. I think your district, the northern county, is where the real change is going to come the next 5, 10, 15 years. Middletown, when I first moved here, Jack, Middletown, Delaware, I swear, was one light and two houses.
Used to turn at the shortstop.
Lord, now it's golf courses, any type of store you want, any type of food you want, and I think they're looking our way.
I don't want to see no Middletown in North County. We have our small towns up there, and they are the growth areas. They have room for mm-hmm. growth. You know, they have land. They have the infrastructure
right.
in place. So I'm okay with it. If it, you know, I'm not a big fan of it just sprawling. You know what I mean? Like Middletown, like you said, it's 10 years.
Plus
Look at the difference.
The state's telling you can't, right? As in our sanitation, aren't we up to our limit on sewage and water in the county? If I'm wrong, you let me know.
Well, so Terrapin is pretty much done, but like Sellersville, their plant has plenty of capacity.
Oh,
Churchill
okay,
is getting ready to do a plant upgrade. So there's those areas, and Sellersville's expanding theirs down to Barkley, and there's some talk about expanding to Millington to help out up there, get rid of that old archaic plant we have up there. We have the septic law where you have to have 20 acres to put 7 homes.
Right.
So that controls it. At that point, you're not going to see no 200 home septic communities like 20 years ago. Right.
Jack, in your district is my favorite place, the Barkley Town Office. I want you to know, I'll drive 10 miles out of the way to stop, take a picture. One day I'm going to do a TV show.
You mean the phone booth?
Yes, that's great. I mean, you have an intersection. You've got the great Barkley Depot, which is actually quite great.
Right, right.
And then you've got this town office. I mean, how many people can they get? Can they get 10?
They don't even meet in there. They meet at the church.
Oh, okay. That's good.
But yes, it was and somebody had told me it was like a post office at one time as well.
It's a tourist attraction for me.
On
my way to Dover, I'll take pictures in. Jack, with just a couple of minutes, I always ask all the commissioners, if you had a magic wand, are there some things besides the CTE school and the broadband, are there some things you personally would like to see you know, do you have a mandate? And Jack Wilson thinks, I want to see this done, I want to see that done. Any secret gems you'd like to...
If I had a magic wand, yes, I would cure the traffic.
Okay.
I honestly, Fred, going, you know, obviously we're getting ready to go in election. I think traffic's going to be a big, it's going to be a big talking point.
Yes.
And if there's one thing that, you know, I could correct with a magic wand, it would be to let people...
Solve that problem.
Because it's a lifestyle disruption. It really is. And I get it. I mean, believe me. You know, people say, well, how do you know you live in North County? I drive across that bridge 4 days a week minimum. You know, so, you know, to me, that is our biggest thing we're facing. And the time frame for it to anything to happen is still 20 years.
Well, so, beyond my lifetime.
Yeah, it's just ridiculous. Yeah. You know,
and so. I think in fairness to commissioners... So much of this is out of your hands, if I understand it correctly. I mean, the state, now you tell me if I'm wrong. I mean, everyone fusses at commissioners at the meetings. Mr. Wilson, it's your fault, and Mr. Moran. Guys, the state is holding all the cards on this one. Does that sound right?
Well, the feds are right now, because we're in the NEPA study, and that's a federal study.
Okay.
So the NEPA one's in, but then the state will have to pony up, I want to say, and Jim knows the numbers a lot better than I do, but I think it's between 30 and 50 million to do the next level NEPA study, which is another 5 years.
And that's just
years.
A study.
And that's just the studies. I mean, I think, you know, and the big controversy now is do we build the bridge where they are now, or do we put it north,
south? Yeah, Rock Hall or
right.
Southern Maryland or something.
And they've narrowed in on that corridor. And, you know, I see the argument from both sides. People don't want it because they think it's going to bring more growth, more traffic. But the reality is we have a lot of people here already, and if those two bridges were to fail, and we have no other source, who's going to want to drive 2 hours south, 2 hours north?
Sure,
you know,
sure.
Home values will plummet. Queen Anne's County it would hurt Queen Anne's County. So really, I tend to look at a bridge going there as a replacement, not we're going to have more traffic. And you know, they're looking at it from a corridor upgrade, going all the way back to 97 and 50, where you really get that first flux of come together, and going down to 404, where basically the traffic splits again because you got people going to Delaware Beaches or they go to Ocean City, right? So I think if they were to put, you know, to fix a lot of that stuff, to keep the traffic moving. My whole thing is keep the traffic moving through here.
The worst
stay
thing
off
is
our
when
side
it's
roads.
90 degrees and you're sitting there still, right? The motor's running, right?
And then people can't leave their houses. They can't go to the grocery store, you know. And we've got a lot of great bike trails and things like that, you know. And I'd like to see, that's another thing I'd like to see. I'd like to see that extended and continue and keep on getting it because, you know, it has.
It's a wonderful trail. I do it every Wednesday and Friday for the sheriff. We ride bikes up and down. And it's amazing, people come here to, not only do they walk the trail, but then they go to our restaurant.
Right.
Then they buy gas.
Yep.
And then they take the kids for stuff. So
it'd be great if we could get it to go up and take it all the way to Chestertown, up into North County, and even to like the Y Mills area, if we could split it there, kind of like the Cross Island Trail, and get that connected. I mean, our trail systems were used extensively during COVID. I mean, it was just tremendous how many people
Jack, we go down Wednesday nights, packed. Walkers, joggers, bikers. Saturday morning when Bill and I go from 10 to 12, let me tell you, with this traffic, you're going to have to build an overpass on the trail. It's so packed.
Yeah.
Now, what would be fantastic, like, you know, what a great, hopefully my children, grandchildren, you could start on Kent Island and go all the way up in your district, right?
Yeah.
I mean, just see the whole county.
That would be a great project. And I know it takes a lot of money. I mean, just that little segment we did, which was pretty much I want to say it was one of the last major water segments he had to do with it, but it was close to $6 million.
He did a good job. Everyone who voted for that, you've got my vote. That was fantastic.
Yeah, no, it came out really nice. And then, you know, we just got to get beyond that now and try to get it to that. To the split would be the next target.
Next step.
You know, get it to there. Because then you're in Queenstown, so now you've connected another town via bike.
Oh, that'd be great. From Queenstown all the way down to Stevensville, the high school down there. Oh, what a great trip that would be.
Then Centerville's next.
Oh, yay, there's hope. Now, Jack, I got to ask you, next week, County Fair.
Yes.
Are you going to be out there shaking hands and patting?
I'm going to be out Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday night. I'm leaving to go down to see my granddaughter that was born during COVID that I have not seen yet.
Oh, congratulations. You haven't even seen her?
No. Pictures and FaceTime.
What's her name?
Tegan.
Terrific. Yes, congratulations.
Yes, thank you.
And you've never seen it.
She's my third one, but yeah, so.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah, so we're going down to Myrtle Beach. They live in Myrtle Beach.
Oh, that's a tough trip.
Yeah.
Myrtle Beach granddaughter, you win.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
Jack, look, first of all, thank you for coming. It's an extremely hot day because I know you got a busy schedule. Yeah. Please don't get on 301-50 today. Stay. Let Moran suffer out in that heat, okay?
He's going to have his hell to pay later, so.
I don't want to talk to him tonight, okay? Hey, I really appreciate you coming.
Thanks for having me on, Fred.
Okay. My name's Fred McNeil. Thank you for joining us. We had Commissioner Jack Wilson, who is very approachable, and I hopefully go out and shake his hand at the county fair. My name's Fred McNeil. My time's up. Thank you for your time. We're going to see you next time.